An exciting day for us. Thank you for joining us, and I want to issue a very special thank you to the U.S. Department of Treasury Assistant Secretary Ben Harris for being with us here this morning in Denver and Colorado, and of course to our very own Congresswoman Diane DeGette, fresh off of her primary victory. Congratulations to you. Let's give her a round of applause. It is good to see all of you, and we have a very special announcement. This is a tremendous day for supportive housing in Denver. We all know that the solution to homelessness is housing, and together with partners, we have been hard at work fostering innovations to help get people housed and stay housed. Today's announcement is a direct result of the momentum we built over the last several years or recent years here in Denver. In June of 2014, just to kind of recall the history of this, at the Global Clinton Initiative, I announced one of the first city-led social impact bond programs in the country with a focus on addressing the challenges of chronic homelessness. At the time, Denver was among the many cities whose jails and emergency rooms had become the most expensive housing and mental health care centers for people experiencing chronic homelessness. Having these individuals stuck in this very expensive cycle, of streets to the emergency rooms, to jails, back to the streets, back to detox, back to the streets, was simply too expensive. In fact, we found 250 people in Denver who, just as we studied them, cost the people of Denver $11 million a year, just those 250 people. Having these individuals stuck in this cycle was wrong, and we needed to take action to address their condition and help them to exit their condition. There was mental health and physical toll on these individuals, a cycle of living on the streets, going to the emergency care or jail and back to the streets was taking on all the residents, but also on the people of Denver. We needed to do something different. And our goal with the Denver SIB or the Social Impact Bond was to leverage private investment to house hundreds of people experiencing chronic homelessness and to connect them to intensive services and case management. A supportive environment that is much better suited to helping them exit homelessness than emergency care or our jail systems. The Denver SIB not only housed over 350 people, but it provided return on investment to all program investors. The program results disrupted the false narrative that these people facing the most extreme cases of homelessness were beyond help. With the offer of Housing First and the right supports in place, people can and did exit homelessness and remain housed and decrease their use of costly emergency services. The success of Denver's SIB set the stage for additional public-private partnerships, which brings us here today. I am very proud to announce the Denver Housing to Health, or H2H, Pay for Success Project, a new program that leverages the framework and partners of the SIB model to house and help stabilize at least 125 additional individuals over the next 7 years. This partnership includes many sectors: federal, state, local governments, nonprofits, healthcare systems, investors, and philanthropic partners. We are honored to have been awarded up to $6.4 million in funding from the U.S. Department of Treasury under the Social Impact Partnership to Pay for Results Act, or better known as SIPRA, and that's what we'll say from this point forward. These are critical funds that will be used to repay impact investors who are fronting some $11.75 million for the program's supportive housing. We expect to use a reduction in federal health care expenditures for our population served, and SIPRA funds will be used to repay investors for these health care outcomes. Additionally, the city will pay for and will pay and repay investors if the project meets agreed upon metrics for housing stability and reduced jail days, just like we did in the SIB program. So today I want to thank a few folks and then bring up our Assistant Secretary to speak. First, again, to the U.S. Department of Treasury, thank you for being our grantor. Colorado Coalition for the Homeless and John Parvinsky, who we're going to hear from in just a moment, has always been and has been a perennial partner of our efforts to end homelessness. WellPower, the Corporation for Supportive Housing, Denver Health, Urban Institute, Social Impact Solutions, our investors, Northern Trust, Colorado Access Foundation, the Denver Foundation, and Gary Community Ventures. Again, other grantors included Colorado Trust, Kaiser Permanente, and we received additional support from the Colorado Department of Healthcare Policy and Financing, Colorado Department of Local Affairs, lead agencies, Department of Finance, and our Department of Housing Stability. Bretta Fisher, our incomparable leader, somewhere in the room. Y'all got to give her a hand for her leadership. And where is she?
She's behind you.
Oh, behind you. And I see a lot of the host team back there. Thank you all. I got to tell you, they're phenomenal. Department of Public Health and Environment and Department of Safety. Will you give all of our village a round of applause for making this happen? What we've always said in Denver is that the city cannot do this alone. We need all of our partners, and I think the day is demonstrative of the partnerships that have to come together, that have to form in a very selfless manner to stand in the gap for those who are experiencing homelessness in our city and a lot of the contributing factors to their condition. So I want to finish by saying this. We clearly know that Housing First works. Our partnership here in Denver has played a role in increasing the body of evidence supporting the Housing First model. We look forward to continuing to implement and advancing this model, but most importantly, we're eager to dramatically improve the quality of life for more than 125 of the city's most vulnerable residents. Those are the impacts that are measurable, and they're the most important impacts that we can focus on. So now, I want to give a warm, ask you to join me in giving a warm welcome to our Secretary of the U.S. Department of Treasury, the Honorable Ben Harris.
Thank you very much. Let me begin by thanking Mayor Hancock on behalf of Secretary Yellen, the Treasury Department, and the Biden-Harris administration for having us here today and for his leadership. I also want to thank the Congresswoman for her support for this initiative and her many years of dedicated service to the people of Colorado's 1st Congressional District. As the mayor mentioned, I serve as Assistant Secretary for Economic Policy at the Treasury Department, where we oversee, and I'll say it one more time, the Social Impact Partnership to Pay for Results Act program, hereforth SIPRA, which is making approximately $5.5 million available to reduce homelessness here in Denver. SIPRA was enacted in 2018 on a bipartisan basis and aims to improve the effectiveness of social services. The federal government makes funding available for selected programs, but only makes payments if pre-agreed outcomes have been met and validated by an independent evaluation. In this way, the program encourages taxpayer investment in projects that produce results. The City and County of Denver's Housing to Health program was selected for a SIPRA grant after going through a competitive process. The fact that this project was selected is a recognition of Mayor Hancock's leadership and the commitment of this community to address homelessness. The federal government's support for this initiative will allow Denver residents who are experiencing homelessness to receive basic housing and health services. I've had the opportunity to work for President Biden for a long period of time. He knows that homelessness and housing insecurity are some of the most significant challenges that a person or family can face. Throughout the campaign, he emphasized the need to tackle homelessness to help those in need and better our communities. Today, by supporting the services provided by the Denver program, which will make a substantial difference in the lives of these individuals and provide benefits to all of Denver, the administration is delivering on President Biden's commitment. This grant will build on Denver's previous work housing more than 250 people experiencing homelessness, who were frequently interacting with police, jails, and emergency care. Denver has shown that when housed and provided wraparound services, people encounter the criminal justice system less often and dramatically increase their use of preventive medical care. Mayor Hancock, thank you again for having us here today. We are looking forward to continuing to work with you as this important effort moves forward. Over to you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Our next speaker is someone who really doesn't need an introduction here in Denver. She has been congressional representative for District 1, Denver, for over 24 years. And again, we're excited that after last night's resounding victory, it looks like she's headed back to continue to represent us. When the earmark program was returned to Congress just a couple years ago, Congresswoman Diane DeGette called me, and this is a true story. The first thing she said was, what can I do to help with the efforts around people experiencing homelessness? And she has helped to deliver resources back to Denver to help us in this effort. So let's give a rounding welcome to our Congresswoman, the Honorable Diane DeGette.
Thank you so much, Mayor, and also thank you, Assistant Secretary Harris, for being here with this great news today. What strikes me when I hear the mayor speak and when I hear the assistant secretary speak is it really does take a village to address homelessness. And this is an issue, as the mayor mentioned, I have been working on for many issues. I was reflecting, John Parvinsky and I talk about this. The first time I started working on this issue was when I wasn't even in elected office yet, so think about that in the midst of times. I was a lawyer practicing here in Denver, and I've been thinking about homelessness ever since. When you hear the mayor talk about all of the different groups who are involved in this initiative, the public-private partnerships, the community groups, it makes you realize that we all have to work together to address this very difficult problem, because if it was an easy problem to fix, it would have been fixed. And so, as the mayor mentioned, last year in the appropriations process, the appropriations committee reinstituted member-directed spending. And I decided rather just get some money and throw it here and there, I would target my money, just like the mayor is doing in these homelessness projects, to trying to address homelessness at every level. And so I was able to get $13 million in money for homelessness and related issues last year. This year, I've once again decided to direct my member-directed spending towards homelessness, and we have requested projects in, I think, more than double the amount of the $13 million from last year. So we're hoping that they will be approved, and if they are, that will go towards even helping more with all of our wonderful partnerships. This particular project we're talking about today, it's a $6.3 million investment, as the mayor said. It's going to have a huge impact on our community. It highlights a model, and I think this is why we're so blessed with the Assistant Secretary's presence today, because I believe this model can be used across the United States in coming up with public-private partnerships to address homelessness. Instead of the federal government, the state government, the local government working separately, duplicating work and not coordinating, what projects like this will do is really help us come to the root of the issue and address homelessness of a community. And you're going to hear in a minute from John Parvinsky, but what this project will do is it'll use the funds to support their recuperative care facility. This will provide our neighbors with a safe place to stay while they recover from illness and operations. Last year, as part of the $13 million I got, I was able to get $2 million approved for this Stout Street facility. And so I'm so happy, Assistant Secretary, that the money that we're getting from the Treasury today will help to build on this. I refuse to say that we can't break the cycle of homelessness. I refuse to say that there are people who don't want a home. Everybody wants a home. Everybody I ever met wants a home. But their circumstances are different. And that's why we have to work as a community to listen to our neighbors, to hear the issues, to hear the concerns, and then work together for all of this. And so we are going to do this together. There's nobody who understands this better than John Parvinsky. John is the CEO of the Colorado Coalition for the Homeless. He's been doing it, as I said, for 36 years. He's getting ready to retire, much to our chagrin, but we're not going to let him go away, because he is really the brains behind not just this operation, but addressing the overall issue of homelessness in this state. John, thank you for all of your work. Over to you.
Thank you, Congresswoman. It was wonderful to get your support for the congressionally designated funding for our recuperative care program, and we'll have another grand opening in August to be able to celebrate that. But today we're here to talk about the housing to home partnership, the SIPRA partnership. And I want to acknowledge Mayor Hancock for his dedication to address the growing needs of homelessness here in our community. It's a daunting task, and the city, with the support, the mayor, with the support of City Council, has really devoted resources to be able to address the needs of our most vulnerable, most marginalized communities here in Denver. And with the help of Britta Fisher heading up the host department, has made a tremendous difference just over the last 5 years. And so this really builds upon it. I was reflecting on this effort, and you know, I've been doing this for 36 years, but it was 20 years ago, in 2002, that we established what we called the Denver Housing First Collaborative, where we got resources from the federal government, the state government, and some local resources to house 100 individuals who were considered chronically homeless and the most vulnerable at the time. And we chose to do a reverse prioritization to those who needed the help most, rather than those who were judged to be most likely to succeed. And we proved after 2 years that we could house, successfully retain housing for more than 90% of that population. And we were able to demonstrate we could save the city funding, hospitals, the criminal justice system over and over again. And so after we were able to build upon that initial 100 individuals, and by the end of the decade, we were housing 400 people with four assertive community treatment teams, providing supportive housing with wraparound services. And when you say, what is that, supportive housing and wraparound services? It's not only the roof over the head and the key to an apartment, but it's a group of staff, some of them here in this room, some of them watching virtually, who do the work to engage individuals on the streets, help them identify what their plans are, what they would like to see their lives to become, and then help them to achieve it, getting into housing, but more importantly, keeping them housed, because it takes a lot of work to deal with folks who have mental health issues, who have addiction issues and health issues, and when they have a bump in the road without that support, they'd be back on the streets turning to us for help. So the tremendous staff here has really made a difference. So when we were approached in 2016 to be part of the social impact bond, I said, well, we've been doing this for 15 years. What do we have to prove again? But we agreed to do this for another 250, and then it grew to 325 with our partnership with the Mental Health Center of Denver. And we were able to demonstrate again that housing first works, if you do it right and if you treat people appropriately. The mayor, the congressman mentioned, you know, people don't want to be homeless, they don't want to be on the streets. And the first 250 people we outreached to under this SIB program, only one said no to the appropriate offer of housing with wraparound services. So that turns that whole notion on its head. So after 5 years and a study by the Urban Institute, it proved again that housing first works. So it seems a little bit like deja vu. Here we are in 2022, again, trying to prove that proposition that housing first works for people who are high utilizers of healthcare and high utilizers of the city's jail system. And we're gonna make it work, we're gonna prove it. And to think that we're going to help 125 people when there's 2,000 people in our shelters and 1,000 people in our streets, we know that that's not enough. So we need to build upon these initiatives to get the community support to make sure that we can bring these solutions up to scale. There's a backlash, you know, and I'm saying this as I I'm contemplating, you know, leaving the field, but there's a backlash growing, not only in our community, but in all high-cost communities that are seeing a rise in homelessness. And they think that these programs don't work because the evidence, when you look at people on the streets, is that the numbers are growing and not decreasing. Mm-hmm. That's not showing that the intervention doesn't work. It's just showing that we're not investing at the level necessary to solve the problem. So we all have to work collaboratively to convince our neighbors that these initiatives do work, and to be able to grow it to the level that we can say truly that we are going to reduce and end homelessness in our community. Supportive housing across the street, that's an example of supportive housing that's been in place for 20 years. 78 units upstairs, and just across the alley, another 98 that'll be finished in August. So we need to just continue to double and redouble and redouble our efforts until every individual, every family who doesn't have a safe place to call home has a safe place to call home. So we appreciate all the support, and I forget who I'm supposed to turn it over to.
Go to Walter.
Walter. Oh. Walter is a great example of one of those individuals that was approached, and he can tell his own story, but a great success of the SIB program.
All right. How are you doing?
Good.
I consider this a privilege and honor to be over here, be able to speak today, and also to tear down some stigmas, like the Congress lady said, and just like the mayor said, putting together an initiative program. And I happen to know a little history of the mayor, where he do have some experience with homelessness, taking care of his own siblings. So he has real compassion. And this program, basically what it did, is like the Congress lady said, no, we do want housing. You know, we do want to be productive. And then I'm here today so y'all can see the truth and the progress in successful housing with the initiatives and the programs that mirror the Congress and everybody involved that actually showed us capacity. And also, in the truth, a lot of times we contribute to homelessness, you know, my criminal activity, my addictions, you know, my lack of responsibility. But with this, with the SID program, they went past that. They looked at the root, at the real problem. They looked at the housing problem, that no one should be able to sleep on the streets regardless of what their situation is. And it was so impressive. I'd like to share a story with you. When I first left going to the street, I went to the National Stock Show, and they housed 800 people during the height of the pandemic. And during that time, I was suffering with sclerosis, which is the curve of my spine, and everybody there was on cots. So not only was I homeless, I was in bad health. Here's a 50-year-old man at the time. A cot wasn't a place to have when you got scoliosis. I'm 6'2", and my spine is curved 20 degrees. Some days I wake up in the morning, I'm crying out to Jesus, please, and I got people next to me helping me up to go to the bathroom. So I seen the worst. I was like, it just can't get no better. So in my daily activities, I'm just going out, putting in housing applications. I'm doing anything just to get a glimmer of hope. So with the SID program, what happened is the coalition, in conjunction with the mayor, put together this comprehensive program, and they came looking for me. I don't think y'all understand what I just said. That was unheard of. They came looking for me to tell me I had housing. I didn't know. To jump up, cry, scream, because I was one person that really needed housing. I was physically unable to maintain. And plus, that stigma about we don't want to be on the streets, I really wanted a place better than anybody, I promise you. So when they found me, they put me together with case management. They explained the program to me. And so in that, my health started to deteriorate. So working with case managers, they put Stout Street inside the shelter to help me with my disability. And also they put me in a subsidized housing, which let me stay there for free until I get my housing. So the mayor with the coalition put together an initiative unheard, unseen. And the main points I'm gonna get to is I was able to go to a place I want instead of being a place that they want to put me. So I turned down two places. I want to change my people I was around in the environment because I knew myself. So I was able to go to a Lakewood in an upscale suburban area, which I've been there for 2 years. The people there don't even know that I'm on housing. I'm just a regular person in the community. Second of all, I've been in here for 30 years. This is my area. I know this good, and I know the ways of everybody down here. I did 8 years of incarceration in prison from this area. I've been out 14 years. I went to college in prison, got a ministry degree. But the thing about it, being in Lakewood, I have zero contact with the police. And 2 years in Lakewood. I don't even know what police look like in Lakewood, unless they're just driving by. I want to personally thank the mayor. I never met him before, but it's an honor. I want to say God bless you, Hancock.
Your
thank you for giving me that chance. I really appreciate that we can tell on these statements what you're doing is not right. It is right. We do want a place. We do want to be protecting our community. Congressman, man, only woman that I know better than you is my mother.
Thank you so much.
I appreciate you. Thank you, sir. And this with these ideals, and like Congress Lady said, a village, that we still have more people on the street. And as long as I got a voice, I'm not going to be happy. Thank y'all so much.
We should stand up on that one. That's the story. Walter, thank you.
We're going to turn this over to Kathy, but as I leave this podium, I know there's a panel coming. Walter, I just wanted to personally thank you for sharing your story and your truth. As you were speaking, I looked at you and I said, this is my brother. This is my brother speaking. That's your brother speaking. Those people on the street. And I just want to finish on a point that John made. People, this is the most complex issue in public policy I've ever dealt with. I've said it 100,000 times. And there are a lot of ideas on how we solve it. Majority of people, unfortunately, who are not in it, believe you should just be able to build housing, it's done. But those of us who are in it recognize we've got to shut down the noise, focus on the soul of a Walter Boyd, and say we can do this one person at a time. So thank you for what you've done. To all you champions in the room, I just encourage you, stay in the battle and do not surrender to the voices who say we're not doing enough, because we're going to keep fighting. And we're going to keep investing until we save and return every soul to a shelter and stability. So thank you, Kathy. You're up.
Thank you, Mayor. Thank you, Walter. Thank you, Congresswoman, the Assistant Secretary. And thank you to my boss, John Pervinsky. These folks will be available for interviews in the back of the room if they're able to stay. We're going to take about 5 minutes, 10 minutes, and shift some things over and bring some panelists up who can answer questions about the program. We're going to have a presentation by Britta Fisher on kind of the structure of the program, and then we'll have a further discussion in this room. So stay put if you're interested in staying put. If you'd like to talk